soul praise him, for he is your health and salvation. Come all who hear, now to his temple draw near. Join me in glad adoration. Praise to the Lord above all things so wondrously reigning, sheltering you under his wings and so gently sustaining. Have you not seen all that his needful has been, sent by his gracious ordaining? Praise to the Lord who will prosper your work and defend you. Surely his goodness and mercy shall daily attend.
Good morning. Welcome to our worship service. The gorgeous music you just heard included a prelude entitled "All for a Closer Walk with God" and a hymn of praise entitled "Praise to the Lord, the Almighty." I welcome you with great joy. It is the first time that I'm able to see my pastor and his beautiful daughter in the flesh. I have been summoned to this office, which I think looks wonderful. And it is with great pleasure that I welcome you to our virtual congregation. It is also a special day for me because it's the anniversary of my father's birth. He would have been more than 100 years old today. So he's very much in my heart as I pray. O God of all creation, Father, Mother, Redeemer, you have gathered us here, Lord, in this place at this time. Therefore, accept our prayers, our humble worship, accept our imperfect love, you who are perfection. Forgive our imperfections. Hold us in your loving hands as we recognize your everlasting mercy and rejoice in your existence, for we trust you. Amen.
Amen.
Our first reading is a gorgeous psalm, Psalm 139. It is dedicated to our inescapable God. O Lord, you have searched me and known me. You know when I sit down and when I rise up. You discern my thoughts from far away. You search out my path and my lying down and are acquainted with all my ways. even before a word is on my tongue, oh Lord, you know it completely. Mm-hmm. You hem me in behind and before and lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is so high that I cannot attain it. Where can I go from your spirit? Oh, where can I flee from your presence?
Thank you, Patricia. For our second reading of scripture, we return to the story of David and Bathsheba. You will recall last week we explored that soap opera scandal where David saw Bathsheba bathing on the rooftop, where he decided that he would go and take her and lay with her, and that he impregnated her. He then engaged in a series of conspiracies and cover-ups in order to secret his sin and ultimately led to the death, the planned death of Bathsheba's husband, Uriah the Hittite. We continue on in the book of 2 Samuel, and we hear from the 11th chapter. We'll do 26 and 27, and then we'll go to the 12th chapter, verses 1 through the first part of verse 13. Let us prepare for hearing of the word of God. When Bathsheba, the wife of Uriah, heard that her husband was dead, she made lamentation for him. And when the morning was over, David sent and brought her to his house, and she became his wife and bore him a son. But the thing that David had done displeased the Lord. And the Lord sent prophet Nathan to David, and he came to him and said to him, you know, there were two men in a city, the one rich and the other poor. And the rich man had many flocks and herds, but the poor man had nothing but one little ewe lamb, which he had bought, and he brought it up. And it grew up with him and with his children, and it used to eat his meager fare and drink from his cup and lie in his bosom. And it was like a daughter to him. And now there came a traveler to the rich man. And he was loath, the rich man was loath to take one of his own flock or herd to prepare for the wayfarer who had come to him, but he took the poor man's lamb and prepared that for the guest who had come to him. And then David's anger was greatly kindled against the man, and he said to prophet Nathan, as the Lord lives, the man who has done this deserves to die. He shall restore the lamb fourfold because he did this thing, because he had no pity. And prophet Nathan said to David, you are the man. Thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, I anointed you king over Israel, and I rescued you from the hand of Saul. I gave you your master's house and your master's wives into your bosom, and gave you the house of Israel and of Judah. And if that had been too little, I would have added as much more. Why have you despised the word of the Lord to do what is evil in his sight? You have struck down Uriah the Hittite with the sword and have taken his wife to be your wife, and have killed him with the sword of the Ammonites. Now, therefore, the sword shall never depart from your house. For you have despised me and have taken the wife of Uriah the Hittite to be your wife. Thus says the Lord, I will raise up trouble against you within your own house, and I will take your wives before your eyes and give them to your neighbor, and he shall lie with your wives in the sight of this very sun, for you did it secretly. But I will do this thing before all of Israel and before the sun. David said to Prophet Nathan, I have sinned against the Lord. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Let us pray. Lord God, we have sinned against you. We are guilty. We are convicted. We have gone left when we know we should have gone right. And we have gone right when you have called us to go left. We've done it all. We've cheated. We've stolen. We've been corrupted. We've had sins of omission and commission, sins of words, sins of thought, sins of deed. We've looked at things that we shouldn't have looked at. We've touched things that we shouldn't have touched. We've taken things that didn't belong to us. We've had sinful thoughts. We've engaged in sinful activities. All of us, Lord God, we are broken. We are imperfect. We are flawed. We may look good on the outside, but we are filthy and dirty and rotten and corrupted on the inside. We've done all of these things in midnight hours, thinking that they were secret, thinking that we would get away with it, thinking that no one would know, think that no one would see. Oh, but Lord God, you know. You see what we do in the dark. You see, even though we call ourselves pastors and elders and deacons and Christians and believers and good people and spiritual people, you see the sinful rituals in which we engage. Lord God, we come to you this morning reflecting on our sinful nature and celebrating your forgiving and redeeming and graceful and merciful love. Lord God, create in us a clean heart. Forgive us of our sins as we confess and repent and turn away from our sins and towards you. Bless us this day to hear a word from heaven. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray together and say together, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. This morning, we return again to the story of David and Bathsheba. Yet another one of our lectionary texts where we see that this great man of God, this one that is said to be one who is after God's own heart, is broken, corrupted, and has fallen all the way down to the ground in his sin. And if we look as much as David was one who knew the Lord, as one who would have known all of the Ten Commandments and known all of the things that he was not supposed to do, if you look closely, as we examined last week, the story of David and Bathsheba, there is more than we tend to focus upon. If we look, Patricia, we can see that David actually broke the last half of the Ten Commandments all in this single set of incidents, the sexual sin of coveting another's wife, the Tenth Commandment, the sexual sin of adultery and fornication, the violence of rape, the violation of the seventh commandment, the sin of conspiracy and cover up, the ninth commandment, bearing false witness, the sin of murder, the sixth commandment, the sin of theft, of stealing another man's wife, the eighth commandment. He had went through all the last half of the Ten Commandments, but I submit to you, there was another commandment. There was an 11th commandment that David seemed to be holding on to, and that is the commandment that the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. said is, thou shall not get caught. He thought that he was connecting and saving himself in his midnight hour with that 11th commandment, thou shall not get caught. Dr. King said this, midnight is the hour when men desperately seek to obey this 11th commandment. Thou shall not get caught. According to the ethic of midnight, the cardinal sin is to be caught, and the cardinal virtue is to get by. It is all right to lie, but one must lie with real finesse. It is all right to steal if one is so dignified that if caught, the charge becomes embezzlement and not robbery. It is permissible even to hate if one so dresses his hating in the garments of love that hating actually appears to be loving. The Darwinian concept of the survival of the fittest has been substituted by a philosophy of the survival of the slickest. This mentality has brought a tragic breakdown of moral standards, and the midnight of moral degeneration deepens. We've had our own midnight moments and meanderings, have we not? You know, I want to ask whether you've been to the so-called sin cities of Las Vegas or Atlantic City. Some of us were there last night. Some of us will be there proverbially tomorrow. Some of us are morally in that degenerate state of midnight right now. I will not speculate about those whose mail that I might have been reading this morning in my opening prayer. Some of it is like junk mail. We all have it in our box, and even if we try to quickly and routinely dismiss it and throw it away to a place that will not be seen. Nevertheless, I submit to you that by the time I finish this sermon this morning, that this particular truth will become self-evident. Even with our best efforts, we ultimately cannot uphold that 11th commandment. We do, and we will get caught. Please meditate with me for just a few moments on this message. What happens in Atlantic City does not stay in Atlantic City. What happens in Atlantic City does not stay in Atlantic City. Family, our sins are not secret. The Gospel of Luke chapter 12, verse 2 says, nothing is covered up that will not be uncovered, and nothing secret that will not become known. If we look in our Bibles, there is plenty of biblical evidence of this truth, going back even before David to the times of Moses. Do we remember the backstory of Moses, the one that we remember as Moses the liberator that had the staff that parted the Red Sea, that brought the children of Israel through the wilderness into the promised land? Well, before he was Moses the liberator, he was Moses the murderer. We go to the book of Exodus, the second chapter. It says, one day after Moses had grown up, he went out to his people and he saw their forced labor. He saw an Egyptian that was beating a Hebrew, one of his kinsfolk. And then what Moses did was he looked this way and he looked that way, and seeing no one, he killed the Egyptian and hid him in the sand. And when he went out the next day, he saw two Hebrews fighting, and he said to the one who was in the wrong, well, why do you strike your fellow Hebrew? And the Hebrew answered, who made you a ruler and judge over us? Do you mean to kill me as you killed that Egyptian yesterday? And then Moses was afraid. And he realized something, and he thought, surely the thing is known. Surely the things that we do in our midnights, the things that we do in our proverbial Vegases or Atlantic cities are known if we look closely to the story of David with all of his efforts to conceal and to cover up. We must make note that even if David was looking this way and looking that way, that he had a high risk of exposure. Those royal police that he sent to go and fetch, to go and get Bathsheba and bring them to him, they knew. Bathsheba herself, she knew exactly what had happened to her. She knew exactly that she had been compelled and forced by the royal house to lay down with the king. Bathsheba knew even the general Joab who David sent to go and put Uriah at the front lines so that he might be killed. There was a trinity of groups that knew what he had done. His sin was not secret. Surely the things were known, and we must know, particularly in this surveillance society in which we live. Surely the things are known. We have I see my daughter over here on her cell phone tracking of cell phones. We have Orwellian algorithms that seek to monitor our thoughts and manipulate our voting and our spending patterns. We have these social media platforms with covert memorandums of agreement and understanding with intelligence and law enforcement agencies that listen to our calls, that transcribe our text messages, that record our Zoom meetings and have photo galleries and electronic folders filled with all the private and risque DMs and pics that we sent and that we thought were for her or his eyes only. Surely these things are known. Don't be shocked now. This is not new. In the Old Testament, it says that there is nothing new under the sun. What happened in Vegas never stayed there. What happens in Atlantic City and the AC never ultimately stays secreted in the AC. The New Testament in the third verse of that 12th chapter from the Gospel of Luke that I referenced earlier says, therefore, whatever you have said in the dark will be heard in the light, and what you have whispered behind closed doors will be proclaimed from the housetops. You can conceal and conspire and cover up, but David came to ultimately understand that there was nothing that he could do to try to wrap it up and fix it, that our spin will not ultimately conceal our sin. And why would we think that if we cannot even hide it from the government, why do we think that we can hide it from God? Nathan was a prophet. In Hebrew called the Navi, he was a messenger of God. A prophet comes to bring a message of what thus saith the Lord. He was sent with a word from God. 2 Samuel chapter 12, verse 1, it says, but the thing that David had done displeased the Lord, and the Lord sent Nathan to David. And the prophet Nathan went to David and laid out this whole description of a rich man, of an abundant man, that had stolen and taken from a poor man, that had taken something that didn't belong to him as his own. A man who had sinned, a man who did not have pity, a man who was corrupted. And the prophet Nathan said to King David, you the man. You the man. You are guilty. You are the sinner. You, King David, the man after God's own heart, you the man. You cannot hide it. You cannot conceal it. You cannot spin it. You cannot bury it. You cannot dump it. Not in Vegas, not in AC, not on a rooftop with a murderous cover-up. You cannot hide it at Motel 6. You the man, and surely the things are known. Galatians chapter 6, verse 7 says, do not be deceived. God will not be mocked, for you reap whatever it is that you sow. Do not be deceived. God will not be mocked, for you shall reap whatever you sow. And family, I just say on this day, on this first Sunday of the month of August, that this is all of us, y'all. If I had it on gallery mode and I could see who's watching, I would say, like Prophet Nathan said to David, I'd say to my brothers, I say, you the man. You're the man. But I would also have to look at that screen where I can see myself looking back at myself. And I have to not only say, you the man, I have to say, I'm the man. I have to look around and I have to say, oh, you the woman. You the man next to the man. You the woman next to the man. You're the man next to the woman. You're the man. You're the woman. I'm the man. We the people. We the people are the ones who have fallen short of the glory of God. We the people are the one who have things hidden in the darkness, so we think. But we must remember the words that Patricia read from that 139th Psalm, verses 1-7. And we take those words that she read, and instead of the singular reference, as it is a psalm of David simply speaking of himself with the I and the me, we must make it plural. Oh Lord, you have searched us and known us. You know when we sit down, when we rise up. You discern our thoughts from far away. You are acquainted with all of our ways, even before a word is on our tongues. Oh Lord, you know it completely. You hem us in. Behind and before, you lay your hands upon us. Such knowledge is too wonderful for us. It is so high that we cannot attain it. Where can we go from your spirit, or where can we flee from your presence? Nowhere. We cannot flee from. And when we sin, those things are known. And as David soon discovered, not only can we not flee from our sins, we cannot flee from the connection that we have to one another and the consequences that come from our individual activities. You know, we're all connected. It's not just I and me, it's we and thee, it's us. And we are all connected. I know the former pastor, Muriel Burroughs from South Africa, taught this congregation about the concept of Ubuntu, the I am we. I am because we are. We are because I am. And oftentimes when we say Ubuntu, we say it as a form of inspiration, that your joy is my joy, that your success is my success, your accomplishment is my accomplishment. And we draw upon words like the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. again that said, we are all caught in an inescapable network of mutuality, tied in a single garment of destiny. Whatever affects one directly affects all indirectly. But I say that there's another side to the Ubuntu. There is not only a positive consequence of the Ubuntu, there is a negative reality that we are also connected to one another in one another's sin. And our micro behavior, our individual choices have macro consequences. We can stand or stumble on the shoulders of our ancestors. And in this present moment, right now, in this day, in this hour, we must understand that our choices affect and impact others in the here and now. Our individual choices, our so-called hidden secret sins, impact our families, our children, our spouses, our churches, our communities, our nation, our world. David learned that he and we are indeed caught up in an inescapable network of mutuality, tied in a single garment of destiny, that whatever affects one directly affects one indirectly. And when we go on in the story, we see that what happened on that rooftop, what happened in that conspiracy, what happened with those cover-ups, did not end with David. David's firstborn child with Bathsheba died of sickness. And as it was prophesied by the prophet Nathan, David's entire family was racked with violence. His eldest son Amnon raped and disgraced his half-sister, David's daughter Tamar. Another one of David's son Absalom then had his half-brother killed after getting him drunk. That same son Absalom then plotted to overthrow and kill his own father. He slept with his father's concubine wives and disgraced them and effectively turned them all into widows. David himself had to flee for his life, and David's son was ultimately killed by that same General Joab that he sent to put Uriah the Hittite on the front lines to be killed. Romans 6:23, the first part of it says very clearly, for the wages of sin is death. What happens in AC doesn't stay in AC. You don't get away with it, not only because God sees it, but because our micro behavior, our personal so-called private choices and decisions have macro consequences that go beyond us individually, that affect families, the people we love, our neighbors, and the communities in which we live. This is why it's important for us to take our faith in the public square. This is why it's important for us to give prophetic words to our kings and to our presidents, to our members of Congress. This is why it's important for us to say there are consequences when you decide that you're so busy that you can't come in and take the vote to make sure that we don't end this policy, which does not allow people to be evicted in the midst of COVID-19. There are consequences when you take back your word on what you said that you would do in terms of voting rights. There are consequences when you go and you stand up and you tell the people of Guatemala, don't come here. I say to you, sometimes because these individual choices and policies have far-reaching impact, we have to go and we have to say to presidents, you the man. We have to go and say to vice presidents, you the woman. Because there are consequences and connections, I can say it to presidents and vice presidents and leaders in the political public sphere, But I've said the same thing to our sisters and brothers in the city of Trenton. Family, we are on our way in the midst of another year with record high numbers of murders in our capital city. And I'll say to you that there have been times and moments in my ministry where there have been people that knew that I knew that they had killed someone. And I'm one that calls upon people to confess. I'm not one that goes and informs like the Roman Catholics. If you come to me with a confession, it stays with me, but I'm going to encourage you to take responsibility. But the way that I have often done that when I've had conversations who knew that they had done something, who thought that they were going to get away with it, who thought that the sin that they committed would remain in secret, you know that it always is going to come back. Oh, they may not get you, but they may get your mama. They may not be able to come and touch you and hold you accountable for what you did, but what about your son? What about your daughter? What about your friend? What about your crew? What about your community? And when you look at the murders in Trenton, you can draw lines one to the other of retaliation, of payback and get back, that we don't get away with it. The consequences of our individual choices and decisions and sins are real, whether it is to us in the here and now, whether it is to our friends, our family, our parents, our children, our loved ones in our community, or whether it be even at the end, in the life that could come after this life. There are consequences, and we don't get away with it. Now you may say, well, you know, Pastor, I've never killed anybody. I mean, and I'm not a policy maker. I'm not a president or a vice president or one who has the ability to set policies and have large impacts on whole communities. But we have to know that our personal secret sins, even when they seem small, even when they seem disconnected from a bigger picture, that is the way it frequently starts. Can you imagine that David, when he was standing up on that rooftop and he was looking and he saw that beautiful woman who was someone else's wife bathing on top of the roof? Can you imagine that he thought that it would go this far? I suspect that David never imagined seeing his family wrapped up inescapably in a mutual network of violence and a garment of destruction, where his daughter would be raped by his own son, and another one of his sons would kill his own son and then try to kill him and then sleep with his wife. And then that person ultimately being killed by the very general that he tried to use as an instrument for the cover-up. The wages of sin is death. But as I finish this morning, Patricia, I have to say, even though what happens in the AC doesn't stay in the AC, there is some good news. You see, oftentimes when we read that scripture from Romans, most people just say, well, the wages of sin is death, and they don't finish the scripture. They don't say what the rest of it is, but if we continue on, it says the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. The wages of sin is death. You can earn those wages. By the things that you do and your sinful life, you can earn that death. You can earn that condemnation. You can earn those consequences. But guess what? There's something that you cannot even earn that is given to you as a gift, that is given to us as a gift, and that is eternal life in Christ Jesus, where we will say, yes, I know that I have done wrong, that I have sinned, but I am not guilty. I am convicted. And in my conviction, I receive the responsibility of the free gift, which is the eternal life in Christ Jesus, our Lord. We have the opportunity to accept this free gift when we confess, when we repent, when we turn from our wicked ways, when we realize that, you know what? We're not going to get away with it. We're not hiding it. It's not that it will never be known. Surely these things are known, but surely we serve a Savior that will forgive us. Surely we serve a Savior that died for us. Surely we serve a Savior that took upon all of our sins and said, I take it and I pay the ransom for you. That is what we remember on this first Sunday. That is what we remember when we know that we all fall short of the glory of God. That is what we remember when we reflect upon the reality that we are perfect in our imperfections. Yet nevertheless, we are in receipt of a free gift that we did not earn. If we got what we earned, death is what we would have coming. But a Lord, our God, gives us a free gift, the gift of eternal life. So even though what happens in Vegas, no, it doesn't stay in Vegas. And what happened in the AC, no, it doesn't stay in the AC. We are going to have to take responsibility for the macro consequences of our micro decisions.
Yes.
But we can give thanks that the Lord our God still has a free gift for us. And just as he held on to David, just as he continued to love David, just as he continued to guide David through, oh, you're going through it, but I'm going to take you to it. That there is a free gift that is available to us. It's not cheap. It's very expensive. But this eternal life has been paid for. And for that, we can rejoice and be glad. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Amen. Our inescapable God, who holds us accountable and forgives all our sins. Brothers and sisters, we belong in a church which has many blessings. And one of our blessings is our pastor, who keeps on reminding us about the relationship between our faith and our responsibility to community. Thank you very much, Reverend Dumbe. You are a blessing to all of us. And on behalf of all of us, I thank you for a sermon, which I hope all of us be restored by. I do remember these sermons throughout the week because they tend to be, as is the case today, extremely well-structured, persuasive, beautifully delivered, and highly erudite. So thank you again. I now invite you, brothers and sisters, to join me in the recitation of the Lord's Prayer. our Father, who art in heaven. Hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the power, the glory. We thank you for your mercy, O God in heaven. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. I'm so thankful that I need not try to hide my sins. Our God sees everything, and our God has paid the price. On this first Sunday of the month, we remember that when the Lord our God was arrested, he first took bread. And after giving thanks, he broke it and he gave it to his disciples, saying unto them, "Take, eat. This is my body that has been broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And family, in the same manner, after supper, he also took the cup. And he said, "This is my blood, the blood of the new covenant, poured out for the remission of sins. Whenever you do this in remembrance of me." And beloved, whenever we eat of this bread, and whenever we drink of this cup, we declare the saving grace of our risen Lord, who has covered and paid for all of our sins until the Lord comes again. Family, let us eat and let us drink, knowing that we can publicly declare that our sins have been paid for and that we have been redeemed. Let us pray. Lord God, we thank you for the blessing of this table. We thank you for the blessing of your sacrifice. We are thankful for what you have done and what you are doing and what you will do. Lord God, we know that we fall short. We know that we all are filled and covered with sins of commission and omission, sins of thought, sins of word, sins of deed. But Lord God, with your sacrifice, you have made a way for us to receive the free gift of eternal life. And for that, we are so thankful. And for that, we say, "I confess." And with that, we say, "I repent." With that, we say that I humble myself, that I turn from my wicked ways, that I turn towards you, Lord God. And as I eat of this bread, I take you into my body, into my spirit. As I drink of this cup, I receive your blood as a covering and a cleansing agent of all of my sins. And I say, thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you.
In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray together and say together. Amen. Amen. Let us prepare to eat of the one bread of life and drink of the cup of salvation.
King of my life, I crown thee now. Thine shall the glory be. Lest I forget thy thorn-crowned brow, lead me to Calvary. Show in robes of light arrayed, guarded thee whilst thou slept. Lest I forget Gethsemane, lest I forget thine agony, lest I forget thy love for me, lead me to Calvary. Let me, like Mary, through the gloom, come with a gift to thee. Show to me now the empty tomb, lead me to Calvary. May I be willing, Lord, to bear daily my cross for thee, even thy cup of grief to share. Thou hast borne all for me. Lest I forget Gethsemane, lest I forget thine agony, lest I forget thy love for me.
Family, together, let us eat of the one bread of life broken for us. And let us drink of the cup of the new covenant poured out for the forgiveness of all of our sins. We eat and we drink with thanksgiving, knowing that through the sacrifice, through the payment of Christ Jesus, we have received the free gift of eternal life. Amen.
Amen. Brothers and sisters, we are very fortunate, and as I said before, we are filled with blessings in this church. This church has actually existed as a shrine, as a beacon in the community for 180 years. And it has been the will of God that has brought us here in order to continue this ministry under the leadership of Reverend Mjumbe. But as we prepare slowly but surely to return in person to worship and to community, we cannot do it alone. We need you. We really do. And I have been here before trying to exhort you to really contribute from your treasure. It doesn't matter if it's a small amount or a large amount, but we need those resources in order to accomplish what we are setting out to do. There are many in our community, both here in Princeton and in the community at large in Trenton, who need our love, who need our succor, who need our presence. They need us to know, they need us to represent our God, because God's will cannot be accomplished without your help, without my help, without our help. So I encourage you to give, either by sending a check to our office address where we're standing ready to receive it, or to donate online, because we have a fantastic webpage. And in doing so, you will be supporting this ministry, the good work of our pastor, and the love of all our congregants. As you meditate upon your generosity and decide to contribute to this collective endeavor, we will hear some beautiful music. And I want to repeat, in this church, we have many blessings. And one of them is Karen Yvette Jones. Karen Yvette Jones is a constant and faithful member of this church. And I see her every morning because she is part of our prayer group. Mm-hmm. And I will confess, I hope that she will not be embarrassed, that she often enhances our prayers by spontaneously bursting out in song. And it is always a magnificent start of the day to hear Karen Yvette Jones sing. And so it is today. She will actually sing now as a soloist, and the title of her offering is God Will Take Care of You. Thank you, Karen Yvette Jones.
Amen. Be not dismayed, whatever betide, God will take care of you. Beneath his wings of love abide. God will take care of you. God will take care of you through every day or all the way. He will take care of you. God will take care of you through days of toil when heart does fail. God will take care of you when dangerous fears your path assail. God will take care of you. Oh, God will take care of you through every day or all the way. He will take care of you. God will take care of you. No matter what may be the test, God will take care of you. Lean weary one upon his breast. God will take care of you. Oh, God will, He'll take care of you through every day or all the way. He will take care of you. God will take care of you.
Amen. Amen. Thank you. Thank you, Karen. Karen, you are such a blessing to us, whether it be early in the morning for our prayers, whether it be as a part of the Sunday worship service. We give thanks for you. We give thanks for the gift that God has given to you. And we are so thankful that you have decided to share it and to offer your blessings and your leadership as a member of the Witherspoon Street Presbyterian Church. Thank you. God bless you.
Amen.
We love you. Amen. Amen.
Love you back.
Family, I'm not going to take a lot of time, but I just want to give thanks not only to Karen Yvette Jones, but I also want to give thanks to our lector, Dr. Patricia Fernandez Kelly, one of my favorite professors at Princeton University and people in the whole wide world. And we are just so blessed that she has decided that she will continue a long legacy of service and commitment to this church. She is a member of our session. She is a ruling elder. She is the leader of our stewardship committee, a co-chair along with Elder Courtney Matlock. And I always give thanks to have Patricia on our side. And when she calls upon you to give, to contribute, I pray that you will listen, because she practices what she preaches, and she knows the importance of sowing good seeds, seeds that will go and bear fruit, fruit that will last. And so I call upon everyone. There are pledge cards that are coming electronically. I pray that you will fill out your pledge cards, that you will make your commitments about what it is that you will give in 2022. I want you to imagine what it is that you think on the best possible scenario, that if everything works according to the way you think it should work, how much you would give, and then add something to that. Because we know that the Lord our God blesses us beyond our expectations and imaginations of what it is that is possible. So thank you, Patricia. I also give thanks for the tech team. Our beloved Lisette Gonzalez-Sosa was away today. She's normally the one working behind the scenes helping us. And today I want to give thanks to my daughter, Lewa Mjumbe, who has provided leadership in terms of our Zoom technology this morning and moving our slides. We always have our commanding generals. We have Elder Sharon Nene Campbell, and we have General Jamie Escarpeta. We give thanks for them and the great work that they do behind the scenes. I give thanks to Aya Mjumbe, who is the one who is behind the camera here in this office and in this space. And I lift up the importance of her work, the way in which we all come together as a team with Michael Gittins, our minister of music, that this is a team that has done so much with so little for so long. And now it is important that we add some members to our team that we do look forward. We do look forward to coming back together. Y'all don't know what you're missing.
Yeah.
Because even in this small space, the Spirit shows up in a way, and to be able to connect with sisters and brothers and family and community is something that we have missed, and we want to return to that sanctuary. But I say to you that we are going to return safely, or we are not going to return at all. You know, we are not going to be hurt or damaged by Alpha, Beta, Gamma, or Delta variant, Epsilon, and beyond, that we are going to move and to operate in such a way that we protect the sacred vessels that are the people of God. And in order to do that, we need people to sign up to serve in various ways. I give thanks to folks like Elder Mary McGriff, who has agreed to get folks registered so we can have the identify the people who will come in, and we can do the contact tracing of all of those individuals who come in. But we also need folks like Bruce Harrison and Leslie Young and others. This is not a spectator sport. You have to be in it to win it. You have to get on the field. We need ushers who will come and will help to set up and to clean up. I know the ushers met last week for a train, or I'm told that they were scheduled to have one on the 31st, but it is important and essential that we have not only the team, but remember, no successful team ever just goes with their starters on the field and that's it. We have to have a bench. We have to have closers. We have to have people who are backups. And so we need everyone to find how you can get in and fit in, either as an usher, even as someone who is setting up, someone who is cleaning up. Come and learn how to do what we do with this technology. If you don't know it now, fine, we'll teach you. None of us knew how to do it when we started this. So we will teach you how to do it. And until you come and let us teach you how to do it, we will not be able to do that hybrid service where we are meeting in person safely and simultaneously continuing to broadcast to all of those hundreds and even thousands of people who watch these worship services either on Sunday morning or throughout the course of the week. So we need you. This is a call. This is an appeal. I don't want volunteers. I want soldiers. I want servants. I want those who are called and sent to do what God has called them to do. And that will represent the pathway for our return back to our sanctuary safely, responsibly. You know, in the Presbyterian Church, and you can say whatever it is that you want to say about us within respect to other churches, but we believe this, and we say it about baptism, and we say it about all kinds of things, without undue delay or unnecessary haste. So we're not going to rush. We're going to do a slow crawl. We are paying attention to what is going on around us and around the world. I say to you that I believe that the best vaccine is patience, mm-hmm. that the best vaccine is caution and intelligence. And we are all going to be 100% connected to those values and principles as we are guided and coming back together. Hopefully this month. This is what we declared. We said this month, in the month of August. I don't know if it'll be next week. Don't think so. Maybe it'll be in 2 weeks. Maybe it'll be in 3 weeks. There's 5 weeks in the month of August. Hallelujah. We got a little extra help just in case. But we don't have to make it to that fifth Sunday, because on the fifth Sunday, we're supposed to be doing baptisms. I mean, that was at least our former practice. And I look forward not only to some baptisms, but even some renewal of baptismal vows, because it's something that I want you to pray about. As we return, as we come back, as we have changed, is it time for us to renew, mm-hmm. to renew our commitment, whether that be in terms of our faith walk, whether that be in terms of our giving, whether that be in terms of our involvement in ministry, is it time to recommit to a life of prayer? I ask for you to pray this morning for the families of Pauline Brown, who you know that we have seen transition from labor to reward. We love her, we miss her. I have been in communication with her family. We're looking to possibly either August the 14th, which is a Saturday, I believe, or August the 28th, as a day that we will celebrate her life and have a service. And we want to do it in our sanctuary. And I need people who are going to be committed and trained so that we will usher, so that we will set up that sanctuary, and we will celebrate her life in a place that she loved to be. So we look forward to that, and keep all of her sons and her daughter and her niece and nephews, keep them lifted up in prayer in this hour. Keep her friends lifted up in prayer. Pray for Shirley Satterfield. Pray for Audrey Mack. Pray for Linda Carson. Pray for those who loved her so much. Pray for me. Y'all don't realize how it hurts pastors when people transition. People who you love and people who loved you, and all of it comes all of the time. The way that I have to pray not only for the family of Pauline Brown, and I don't have to pray certain kind of prayers because I know that she's better, and I know that she has her teeth and she can hear everything, and she's dancing, she's playing golf in heaven. But I ask you to join me in prayers and praying for those who are on their way to recovery, to pray for Reverend David McAlpin, who continues to recover from a severe stroke. Pray for his daughters, pray for his sons, pray for his family, pray for those who love him. Pray every single day. Don't forget. If you need a reminder, join us at 7 a.m. for the morning prayer, because we're going to pray for him every single day. Pray in the morning, pray in the afternoon, pray in the evening, pray as scripture says without ceasing. Pray for Joan Thomas. Pray for our sister who we love so much, who we miss so much, who is so an essential part of our ministry, our work. Presbyterian women, international ministry. Who's willing to stand in the gap? Who's willing to continue the legacy and the tradition as she heals and as she recovers? And pray for her family. Pray for her children. And pray for all of those, such as the Deacon Board. I give thanks to the Deacon Board and Deborah Rakes Colbert, who are, once again, are organizing folks to take a day and a time where they can come, maybe only for an hour, just to go and visit with her outside, masked, socially distanced, but spiritually present with her, so she knows that she is loved, so she knows that she is cared for. And there are people whose names that we haven't called and people who we haven't seen, and I just want to say to so many of you all that we miss you. We miss Walter Daniels. We miss having the opportunity to see him. I miss Norma Wilson. I we used to see her on Facebook all the time, haven't been seeing her as much. I miss Rebecca Campbell. I'm so happy that I get to hear her voice on our prayer calls in the morning, but I miss being able to see her as I saw her at the picnic. But you know, we need to come back together, and we have to do the work. We have to do the work that is necessary so that we can return to our church. So do an assessment. Am I giving as much as I can give, and then even more beyond, into that zone where I think that I can't afford to give? Because that's where faith is. If you just give as much as you think that you can afford in terms of your time, treasure, and talent, there's no faith in that. That's just responsible budgeting and math. But faith says, I'm going to go beyond what it is that I think that I can do, because God will take care of me. I am not the one who can manage it or cover it or spin it or control it. That ultimately, in all of my brokenness and all of my sins and all of the ways that I fall short of the glory of God, that it is Christ Jesus that saves me and makes a way out of no way. So pray with me for our church. Pray with me for our church members. Pray with me for our community. And I give thanks to Unidad Latina in Axiom, New Jersey, and Princeton Mutual Aid, and all of those who come together and commit to serve and to feed folks from the porch of this building. I give thanks for all of those who are continuing to work around the issue of violence in the city of Trenton. I give thanks for all of our ministries that are getting geared up and getting ready to return, because we will not come back the same way that we were before. We're changed, we're different, we're saved, we are redeemed. Let us pray. Lord God, we give thanks for the blessing of this day. Lord God, we lift up the family of Pauline Brown. We lift up Reverend Dave McAlpin. We lift up Joan Tomlin. We lift up all of the members of our church. We lift up our friends. We lift up those who are in our community. Lord God, we want to see each other. We want to connect with each other. We want to be with one another. We want to be with you, Lord God. Show us the way. Give us the path. Lord God, we know that you have saved us. We know that you have redeemed us. We know that by your blood, we have been cleansed and we have been set free, Lord God. So now that we are free and free indeed, let us act like it. Let us talk like it. Let us walk like it. Let us be like it. Let us move forward as your people called by your name. Lord God, we love you. We praise you. We honor you. We glorify you. We look for you. Protect us. Protect us from Corona-19, COVID-19, COVID-20, COVID-21, Alpha, Beta, Gamma, Delta, and anything that goes beyond. We know that you are the Alpha and the Omega. You are the first and the last, and you provide for our protection for everything and every day that lies within. Thank you, Lord. We give you all the praise, all the honor, and all of the glory. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray together and say together.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Sisters and brothers, it has been a wonderful, full morning, a precious worship service. I feel very honored to have been with you as we worship God. And I'm here to bid you a farewell, to wish you a very, very happy week. May your memories return to this place as we move through time and space. Our sending hymn is entitled Nothing But the Blood. And after the benediction you and the amen, always beautiful, you will hear a postlude entitled Stand Up for Jesus. God bless you all.
What can wash away our sins? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Not a conspiracy, not a cover-up, not a secreting of a weekend in Vegas or in Atlantic City. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. For my pardon, this we see. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow, and I'll say that makes me black as black gold oil coming from the ground. We are purified. We are made clean. We are saved. We are redeemed. We are made whole by nothing but the blood of Jesus. May the Lord our God bless you and keep you, guide you and lead you, continue to call upon you and give you ears to hear, because we have been saved. We have been set free. We have been cleansed and made free indeed by nothing but the blood of Jesus. Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen.
Let the church say amen. Let the church say amen. God has spoken, so let the church say amen.
Let the church say amen. Let the church say amen. God has spoken, so let the church say amen.
Thank you.
tub?
No, we don't have no tub downstairs. We have a shower stall upstairs.
What size is this flex room?
Flex room is small.
It's 12 by the.
Yeah, it's okay. Like a little office. It looks about like, the size of
your
room.
Yeah.
So they can, everyone can see.
The real big.
Let me start your video. There we go.
There you go.
Everything else is about the same size.
Well, they can see all of you. It's just the screen. But
have
two. Let me see. Hey, everyone.
Hi.
Good morning.
Good morning, everybody.
Jamie,
God bless you. Aaron, Elsie, Dan. Hi. Patricia, such a pleasure to hear your voice.
You're the star.
Thank you all.
Bruce Campbell.
Girl.
Hi, everybody.
Hi, Linda.
Good morning.
Thank you, Sharon.
Thank you for tech team.
Hi, Elsie. I look forward to hearing the sermons every week.
How are you?
I really do.
Great seeing you all.
Hello, Earl.
That
was a great lectureship, Patricia.
Thank you.
Hi, Cecilia.
Hey, Bruce.
Hi, Joan, are you out there? It's Linda. I hope you're feeling much better.
How are you doing, Angela?
How are you doing?
How are you?
Good morning,
everyone. Nice to see you.
Take care.
How you doing, Mariamu?
Yes. Bye. Everyone have a great week.
Bye-bye now.
Bye. Now we can see
thank
you,
Bruce. Karen. Thank you very much for the music.
Yes. Thank you, Elsie.
Yes, thank you, Karen.
Amy,
yes,
nice to meet you. Thank you for that this morning.
Thank you, Patricia.
Thank you.
All right, good. Right. Thank you.
Everybody have a great week and a great day.
Yes, absolutely.
A blessed day.
God bless you all. All right, thank you.
Bye-bye. Morning, Reverend.
We're going to end the meeting. We're going to get to jump over to our debrief. I got you, Jamie. I got you.
All right.
Stay blessed.
All right.
It's over. Bye. Bye. Hang out for just maybe a few more minutes.
Thanks,